Welcome to the Innovation and Technology Management Seminar Series hosted by the Engineering Management Program in the Pratt School of Engineering at Duke University. My name is Jeff Glass, and I'm the Faculty Director for the Engineering Management Program. The purpose of our seminar series is to introduce engineers and scientists to various business and management concepts that they will find useful throughout their careers. Speakers represent a diverse array of industries from finance and information technology to materials processing and biotechnology. If you'd like to learn more about the Engineering Management Program at Duke, including these podcasts and any associated audiovisual materials that are sometimes available, please visit our website at memp.duke.edu. Thanks for your interest in our series, and please do not hesitate to contact us with suggestions or questions.
Well, thank you, Latondra, so much. Latondra and I go way back when we were working at IBM together, like in early 2000 or something. So my name is Dragana Mendel, and today I will be talking to you about the startup environment. Just briefly, the agenda for today, I will explain a little bit to you my career path. How did I get to the point where I am today? And I will spend the bulk of the presentation actually, what do you need to pay attention to if you want to join an existing startup? And then I will segue into the part of the conversation explaining the different resources of organization that can help you here in a triangle if you want to launch your own company, your own startup. And at the end, we will have plenty of time for Q&A. So by raising hands, how many people here in the class have a computer science degree or a computer engineering degree? About a third? Okay. Well, actually, when I did this chart, I had to do a little bit of math, and actually it really struck me that it's been 18 years since I have received my bachelor in computer science. That was at the University of Texas at Dallas. And when I graduated, I started working for Alcatel as an embedded software engineer. Back then, Alcatel was still Alcatel. It did not require Lucent. That happened later on, so the company changed name to Alcatel-Lucent. So I was working for Alcatel for 7 years, again, as an embedded software engineer in real-time operating system environment. So what that means is I spend every single day in a lab designing and developing software for a variety of telecommunication equipment. And the whole focus was to really hone your software engineering skills to make sure that the software you design is going to be fast because it's a real-time operating system environment and doesn't need rebooting like some companies that we know around here. They'll tell you, it doesn't work, just reboot it. You just don't have that luxury when you're designing software that has to run for 10 years at a time. So for me, that was a tremendous engineering experience to have that opportunity. But on the other hand, I had no idea who would buy that stuff. Who was the customer? What did they do with it? I was completely removed in that role from any business development, marketing, or in operations of the company. I was completely clueless. So in the meantime, I have earned a Master in Computer Science from North Carolina State University, and at that time I changed my jobs and started working for IBM. So once I started working for IBM for Autonomic Computing, which was a startup within IBM, my world started to expand. So instead of wearing only one hat, not like that, bigger of speech, I started having a couple of different functional roles. So yes, I was still a software engineer, that did not change. But I was also being in charge of technology commercialization. So what that meant was I was keeping relationship with a couple of universities and their computer science departments, keeping tab of what's going on in research in computer science. And once we as a team have identified the research that is very relevant to the products that IBM is developing at that time, we will take that research and we will make sure that that professor and their department are collaborating very closely with IBM research staff. So they will try to keep commercializing, keep putting more meat on that idea or algorithm or software. And then after a certain point, when the IBM research is done, I will probably take that those demos, proof of concepts, algorithms, whatever that has been done, and push that into appropriate product development environment within IBM. So through that process, I learned that there's something really important, and that is a customer. So I know most of us are engineers, and we all like to have as many features as possible, as many gadgets, and making things complicated, because making complicated things is really cool. But customers that really don't care about cool gadgets and features, they want to solve the problem. They need to have tools that will help their pain into their day-to-day lives. That was the lesson learned for me through the commercialization process, to really be mindful about who is my customer, what do they need, and how do we as engineers deliver the solutions that they need. So at a certain point, I realized that I really liked the business development side, so I went back to school and got myself an MBA, again from the NC State University, and my focus has been on entrepreneurship and technology commercialization. So at that time, my world completely changed, and instead of being part of the large Fortune 500 company, I went all the way down to the startup environment, you know, being as small as it can be. So through my MBA experience, I was also one of the officers of the Net Impact Club. During that time, I was also working as a consultant for Small Business Technology Development Center. And I was working mostly for a number of startups in clean tech space. So those startups were trying to solve the problems around the biofuels, advanced renewable chemicals and materials, LED technologies, and so on. So obviously, how can I change technology from being software engineer focused to material science focused, which is just a struggle. But business model is business model. You're trying to make technology viable in the marketplace. So through my involvement with and leadership in clean tech startups, I became an ambassador for North Carolina for the Clean Tech Open Southeast Region Accelerator, which is one of the largest it is the largest accelerator in the nation for the clean tech startups. So from that point of view, I'm really happy that you see right here in the hallway at Duke, you know, a couple of smart home projects that you're already working in that area. So today, I'm also a consultant for small businesses and startups and helping them define their business strategy, go-to-market strategy, business model, and so forth. So this chart presents a list of the services I'm doing today. Like I said, I'm providing mostly the interim executive support to the small business and the startups, because one thing being a small company is that no matter how many wishes and dreams and plans you have, you never have enough resources, enough people to actually execute into that strategy. And that's pretty much where I come into the place. I kind of lend them a helping hand, providing a sounding board to see if that business model and business planning is going to be viable, whether they're targeting the right customer, making sure that they're doing the proper market research and that they have a sound go-to-market strategy. Well, that was enough about me, so let's talk about why we're all here today. So I think at least half of you are probably going to graduate in May, so probably you're thinking about, okay, I need to get a job. And I am sure that Duke University Career Services, they have wonderful staff that have actually taught you how to go about that process. So the first thing that you typically do is like, okay, which industry I would like to work in? Like, okay. And then you're going to look at the list of companies that are major players in that industries. And, you know, you want to evaluate which company is the best fit for you. Obviously, everybody wants to work for a company that is successful. So for a publicly traded company, that information is so easy to find. It's everywhere in the news, and you can go and look at their quarterly filings with SEC reports and see their financial statements. Hopefully you all have some financial experience by now. So you can see what looks good on paper and what doesn't look on paper. So you make a list, a short list of your desired companies you want to be part of. And the next step is, do a little networking, informational interviews, to try to understand what is the corporate culture of that company, so you can see if that's something that is good for you, for your personality, if that's more than it would be part of. So everything goes well, you know, you get an interview, you know, you go through the whole process, you get a job offer, and you set your first day at work. And on the first day, just like any other established company that has their HR department already in place, they're going to spend the whole day with you, making you read a bunch of documents, and you just sign them at the end, and you don't really don't pay attention about the legal aspects of the documents you're signing. You just do because, you just sign because they tell you how to. You go to your desk, and you work really hard for a month, you're real happy, and by the end of the month, you get your paycheck. Now, how many of you will ever think that when you get a job with a large publicly traded company, after a month, you will not get that paycheck? Probably nobody. In a startup, you have to ask the question yourself every single day. What am I doing and what can I do to make this company, this startup, viable? What can I do to grow this company so all of us in it are successful? So this is kind of segue into my main portion of the presentation. The startup community is very vibrant, and we have seen unprecedented number of new companies showing up every day. I think in the last couple of years, the rate of companies being started has been the highest in a couple of decades. And it's really cool and wonderful to be part of the startup. There's definitely that environment that, you know, everybody wants to have a company, everybody wants to be a part of the startup culture, which is wonderful for innovation. But there's one statistic that has not changed for 50 years, and that is that in 5 years, half of the new companies will go out of business. So what I want you to do is to be really realistic about success of any new company showing up on the market. So I want you to kind of give you a couple of steps that you need to pay attention to as you're making a decision whether you want to join a certain startup team or not. So those four areas that you have to pay attention are, number one, people. You work with people. We all work with people. Do you get along with them or not? It's very simple. Number two, the business viability. What do you think is the probability of that successful company being successful? Not what the founders say. What do you think? The third area I want you to focus on is cash burn rate, which is how much money they have on hand today and how long that money is going to last. And finally, pay attention to what you're signing. In a large company, you know, probably don't have a wiggle room. You just have to sign whatever they give it to you. But in a small company, that's not the case. So let's get started. So first area, people. People make businesses. People make corporations. It's not the other way around. So you will either get along with the people you work with or you don't. When you start networking and start meeting other entrepreneurs, and founders and co-founders, you will immediately feel whether you are whether you feel comfortable around that person or not. And that's very important. Just listen to your intuition. See how you feel in conversation with these people. Because that's something you cannot change. You cannot change who you are. And you will either get along with certain people or you don't. And that's very important to recognize pretty fast. Like when I was working in IBM, there was a saying that, you know, if you don't like your boss, just wait 6 months and he or she will change. And that's true. In a large company, when you have thousands of employees, people change teams, change bosses, change managers, colleagues all the time. And people may change around you, and if you want to initiate the change, it's really easy within a large company to move around, change projects, and start working with a different team. In a small company, when you have 5, 10, 20, even 30 people, you simply do not have that luxury. You don't. So you either get along with that, you're going to value the corporate culture they're building, you're going to be part of it, and if you are not matching up from the day one, just go. Just don't do it. Walk away. You will find a different place where you'll feel more welcome and more comfortable. But beyond the personal chemistry, you have to look at startup co-founders about their professional skills. Do they have the right set of experiences to actually execute the strategy they want to see? Because we all have ideas, we're all smart, we have, you know, tons of ideas we like to see, but what makes the company successful is the ability of their executive management to actually execute on that strategy. The same goes with the employees. Take a look whether the existing employees have a good set of skills and mix of different areas that you need to execute different operational tactics within the company. Now, the second area where I would like to focus on is who are the people that are affiliated with the company on the outside. So if the company already has boards of directors established, that's fantastic. I mean, that's a clear sign that the company founders trust outside expertise, opinions, and are taking it seriously, but formalizing and having board of directors and setting up monthly or quarterly meetings. Now, beyond board of directors, you may also see whether the company has advisors, whether they're in business capacity or scientific capacity. Now, if the company does not have board of directors or any advisors, I will pause and think and ask myself, why is that the case? And entrepreneurial ecosystem, people who are part of it, they're very supportive of each other. And people in general like to help each other out. So all you have to do is find people who you admire and respect professionally and ask them to be your advisor. And most of the time, people will say yes. So if the company that you're talking to does not have anybody and no advisors, what does that mean? Now, we talked about that ideas are cheap. It's all about execution. So for me, my personal value is I value transparency to a great extent. And if I were looking to join a startup, I would ask for a business plan. Hey, do you already have a business plan? Can I see it? And let's say they do. It's like, oh, fantastic. And they wanted to share the business plan. That's even better. I mean, that's huge signs of confidence. So let's say you got lucky and they give you a business plan, and just read it. Read it, evaluate it, critique it. Use all your business skills that you're getting in school today, all your engineering experience that you already have, and evaluate that technology independently and make up your own opinion about whether your degree agree or disagree with the business plan that you have seen. Now, that's the good scenario. I think most of the time you will get kind of response like this lady in the picture. I was like, wow, business plan? Are you kidding me? You think I have time to write a business plan? By the time I write one, it's already obsolete. And that's probably the response you're going to get and most of the time, but which is unfortunate because actually spending the time to actually write something on paper, your whole vision and strategy, has shown statistically that piece of document is going to double the probability of you getting external funding. Now, let's make an assumption, which is very likely, that they don't have a business plan and they're not giving you one. So what is your next step? Business plan or not, the founders of the company, they should be able to clearly articulate what is their business model. So I'm not sure if you're in marketing class, if you are learning about this business model canvas or not, but it is very, very simple but very effective tool designed by Alexander Osweiler and being used and recommended heavily by Steve Blank, which is the author of The Lean Startup, which is simply describe the nine building blocks of the business and how they connect to each other and what do you need to have in each block to actually make the business successful and to run it. So I'm not sure if the people here, the company founders and management will have a business plan like that with sticky notes or some kind of drawing, but it shouldn't be that difficult to kind of like jot that down. From your perspective, the area where I would like you to focus on is the value proposition. Value proposition is simply why is your company product so much better than the industry average that the specific customer segment we want to buy it. I know it sounds simple, but with all the startups that I have been part of, this is probably one of the hardest things to articulate when you're dealing with a new technology that you wanted to commercialize. And when I say better, I want to see a number. How much better? When you talk about in general, like better, cheaper, faster. You know, better, cheaper, faster by how much? 30%. 30% or more is going to have everybody pay attention. If you're talking about incremental improvements over the existing solution, you know, 5%, 10%, that's not going to make anybody excited. It's not going to be a startup company. It's not going to be a high-growth company. It may still be a very viable business, but most likely that type of scenario, you probably have to bootstrap the company with your own resources and funds and kind of grow slowly as you keep acquiring your customers, which is totally fine, but it's not a high-growth startup type of company. So from that point on, I really want you to do your homework. And your homework is to do the market research. To really do the market research on that industry to see who are the other companies playing that space, what do they do, how difficult it is to launch a new company within that industry, what the customers are really looking for, how big is the market size. If you're talking about a couple of $100 million of the complete market size, that's not very attractive. And the rule of the thumb is, you know, I want the market size to be at least, let's $1 billion, and within $1 billion, you can gonna carve out a tiny little portion of that for yourself. If you start off with a really small market size, as it is, not very attractive. So you have to kind of like piece everything together and then do your own homework and evaluate whether the business is going to work and compare that with a story that you have received from the company founders, company management, through all your interactions so you can make your own decision. The third area that's really important is, you know, company finances. Again, kind of in the spirit of transparency, you can ask, okay, do you mind showing me your pro forma financial sheet? And let's say they agreed that to show you that information, and they give you, you know, the cash flow, the balance sheet, and financial projections. Well, right off the bat, I can tell you, you know, any investor, anyone who has been around is probably going to discount completely any financial projections. Because let's be honest, I mean, who can really say how much money you're going to make 3 or 5 years from now? I mean, it's just random. You can't. So it's not an important metric. What's really, really, really important is to see how much money they have today in a bank and how much money the company spends month after month to pay for their operations. And then you can have a little hypothetical chart and say, okay, with the money that we have in the pocket today, you know, we may run out of money in 6, 9 months or 12 months or so. So at that point, you should probably gauge your financial risk. How much are you willing to tolerate? You know, kind of company teetering on financially close to zero before something major happens, and how much you can actually contribute to make that happen for the company. So my personal preference is to see, you know, somewhere 6 to 9 months cash in hand. And but you may have different standards. It's all individual. The reason why this is important is there were a couple analysts that have done some data mining, and they have realized that on the average for the last maybe 5 or 10 years, it takes on the average 13 months from between seed funding and by the time the startup closes on the Series A round. So Series A is when company receives that first big fat check from the venture capitalist. That's like a couple of $1 million range. So with, you know, $1 million in the pocket, you can actually really start hiring people and getting to the marketplace. Now this number is, I would not take this number here in this triangle area, because this number is heavily skewed toward startups in Silicon Valley, and they have much easier access to venture capital. So I would probably kind of give maybe 6 months to this number. I would, here in Dragula, I would call it maybe a year and a half between seed funding and closing the major round. A year and a half or so. Because statistically speaking, when they were tracking those companies that did not close within the average time, they were kind of going downhill from that point on. The other important metric is that getting that check does not happen overnight. The due diligence process typically lasts 6 months, if not longer. So from the time the company CEO, and the company CEO has to be the number one salesman for the company, contacts the potential investor, from the time they actually go through every single piece of paper and product, the prototype you have made in the company, to the time they actually write you a check, it's going to take at least 6 months. If not, probably here again in the triangle, it's going to take a little bit longer. I mean, one of the local angel investment groups are kind of quoting, it takes 9 months to get everybody together and actually write you a check for a couple $100,000. So with those numbers, you can kind of see where the company is in the cycle and how long that will kind of be floating in financial uncertainty until something happens for the better. And finally, let's say you have done your homework, you really like the people you're going to be working with, the team is awesome, there's fantastic chemistry, they have good experience, with your skills you can contribute significantly to the company's success, you like the business model, you really believe there's a huge growth potential, you know, financial picture is more or less okay, you're comfortable with taking that risk, and by the end of the day you get some legal documents to sign. Well, unlike in the previous scenario with the HR meeting a large company, this time I want you to read that document line by line, 3 times, and take notes. And then hire an attorney. And talk to that employment attorney. Just don't sign whatever it's been given to you. It is so critical and so important. If you can't hire an attorney, at least go, I'm not sure exactly where the law school is from here, but go over to the law school and they have the student clinic and the law students will be more than happy to help you out with that and explain if there's something that you should be concerned about the whole benefits package or not. So in terms of the whole, that legal document, you know, this is kind of spelled out, you know, obviously, you know, your function, the title and the responsibilities, seniority level. And that will translate into how much equity stake you're going to get into the company, whether they're going to be straight shares or options or the strike position for the options, how long is going to be your vesting schedule, are you going to get some performance bonuses, what do you have to do to earn a performance bonus, and the salary. So it's a whole lot of things. It's a very complex document. So in terms of salary, for small businesses and startups, you cannot expect a large, nice salary. You know, statistically speaking, small businesses or startups will probably offer you significantly less, you know, 30% less, maybe even 50% less than what you will get for the same position, for the same seniority level with a large company. So you can kind of extrapolate, you know, okay, for this role, I will get, you know, Lenovo or somewhere else in a triangle this much money. You know, you can see if they're giving you a fair offer or not. Here in the U.S., you'll probably get more. So the company has to compensate for the lack of that salary benefit with equity portion of the company. So the younger the company is, the more equity stake you're going to get because you're taking more risk. The older, if the company has received, let's say, Series A funding and they already have a couple million dollars from the external investors, I would probably think about low single-digit numbers in terms of equity stake for the company. You know, 1 to 2% maybe for engineer or senior engineer role or maybe director level or for the business development role. VP titles or so will probably take be double in that. So that's kind of the range you can kind of expect. So that's why I want to go back to the point of talking to your attorney, because the local employment attorneys that have seen hundreds of these employment plans, so they kind of have a good feel of what's customary, kind of the whole benefit package for a position you are applying for. Well, I'm sure some of you are kind of sitting here like, okay, I don't want to join a company, I want to start my own company. How do I go about that, and how do I get help with that? Well, everything I said in the first part of the presentation, when you are the one in a role of evaluating somebody else, now you have to kind of put the evaluator hat back on and say, okay, what do I have to do to make sure that when somebody else evaluates me and my company, they give me the thumbs up? So everything in this first part of the presentation still applies. Now, you know, before you even get to that point, you kind of have to develop a plan. You have an idea, and you're trying to figure out whether the idea is it's going to work or not. And like I keep emphasizing, ideas are cheap, that they don't take a lot of time to generate one. So the first thing you want to do is do a lot of market research. And, you know, being part of the Duke University, it's really easy to go through the library databases and get a lot of market research reports for almost any industry you can think of. And then you can see whether that industry is growing or not, who is the competition, how hard it is to get into that industry, how hard it is to do customer acquisition, and so on. Just do your basic homework marketing 101, you know, do your Porter's Fire Forces and see if that's going to work or not. So after you have done your homework, I want you to go out there and talk to as many people as you can find. Talk to the industry experts. Talk to the people who are already working in the industry so to understand what are they facing on a daily basis. And then talk to as many customers as you can. Because no company has failed because of lack of ideas. Companies fail because they don't have customers. And when you're doing the interview of the customers, be very mindful of how you ask questions. Don't ask leading questions. Don't ask simple yes or no questions. And talk to them. Go pick up the phone. Be on the phone. Talk. Meet them in person if you can. Just do not rely too much on the electronic form of communication on the internet or, you know, Facebook. Hey, do you like this idea? Sure, thumbs up. Of course. I mean, what are you going to say? I have seen, you know, a number of pitches where, you know, people say, oh, we have this cool idea, a couple of us, we came together, we made this cool app, and then we send this survey monkey to all of Facebook friends and be asked, do you like this app? Yeah, sure. That's not market research. You have to find people who you don't love, who don't know, figure out what is their profit. You have to find my friends. If you want to make an app, you have to find my friends and see if they're going to like it. Because probably my circle of friends does not overlap with yours. And you do a prototype and you go through this customer discovery process over and over again. You keep changing your strategy, you keep rehearsing. You know, at this time you're not really spending a lot of money, you're spending your time and energy and focus and talking to people, but you're not putting the physical money into it. Until you are really settled on to the business model that you think is going to work, you're going to have drawn, you are down on the 18th iteration of your business model canvas, and you think you like this one. So hopefully everything is going to turn well, and you know, you can attract your founders, co-founders, your pilot, and launch a company and be successful and profitable, and everything else is history. But no matter what you do, just don't do it alone. Talk to people, get help. Entrepreneurial community is very supportive of their members. So right here, take advantage of the fact that you're at Duke University. There are a lot of business clubs that will support startups and entrepreneurs. So these are just two of them. You have the Startups Challenge, and go to the FIFA School for Entrepreneurship and Venture Capital Club, and start attending their meetings and start to get to know like-minded people. So you're a great place. You just start to have to connect with other people on the campus. Now, in terms of entrepreneurial ecosystem, we are pretty fortunate that the startup community and supporting organizations here at the Triangle are quite large and quite vibrant. So universities, all three universities, Duke, NC State, and UNC Chapel Hill, they all have business schools and number of different clubs, student clubs, that will help you meet like-minded people that have speakers and panels and presentations and startup pitches and all kinds of stuff that you can be part of. The fact that you're a student right now, it's tremendously nice because you can enroll into tons of different business planning competitions all over the country, the schools all over the country. So that's a really good experience for you because that will force you to actually write the business plan, because you have to enter the competition and practice your pitch, practice your presentation in a safe environment. And if you're really good, you may even win some money, but during that process, you will get a lot of feedback. What the judges have found that really resonates well with them, and that will give you a lot of feedback for you how you can improve. And finally, with universities, if you are part of the research group and you have a research project that you're working on that you think it may have commercial potential, you need to go back to Tech Transfer Office and they will be more than happy to work with you and explain how the commercialization works in terms of getting the research ideas out from the university environment out in a corporate world. Now the second area, second type of organizations that can be really helpful to you are accelerators. And we have a number of them in the area. So what the accelerators do is they have the admission process where they will take application for the startups and select limited number, only few at a time, of startups into their program. I'm sure most of you have heard about Y Combinator and TechStars. I mean, they have a lot of buzz on the national scale, but we have a number of them here locally too. So what they do, the accelerators, they take a couple of companies in their program, and the startups, they go to intensive boot camp education in business development. So during that time, they get education in the business modeling, writing a business plan, protecting the intellectual property, the patent process, the legal aspects, hiring people, operations, management, all the different aspects that you need to understand and know if you're running a business, because you're not only an engineer anymore, you're running the whole business, and it's much more complicated. Accelerators, they all have entrepreneurs in residence. Those are people who have built successful companies in the past, and they want to give back to the young companies and educate them and share their experience. For the participation in an accelerator, typically you will get even financial awards, some money to help you along. The money can range anywhere between $10,000, $20,000, and it can be up to $100,000, even $200,000. But no matter what is the financial payoff for being part of the accelerator, it's not all about money. And going back to statistical data, what has been found to be the key differentiating factor to startup success is how much mentoring and guidance outside of the company they have received. So money is nice, but it's not all about money. It's about building a community of advisors around you. And that's what accelerators will give that to you. Now, for all that work, the education they put in, they will probably take an equity stake in your company, and how much they take out of your company, that's all individual. That varies. Incubators, they're another place where you can start meeting like-minded people, entrepreneurs, and advisors, and service providers. The way they work is they have large office space where you can pay the rent, not for the whole month, for the portion of the month. It can be one day a week or a couple of days a month or so on. So you kind of pay a prorated rate depending on how much time you're going to have the dedicated desk or office or a part of the large co-working space per month. Now, with incubators, if you look at the straight dollar amount, how much you have to pay for square footage to be part of that office space, versus the dollar amount you will pay for square footage in any office park here in Durham, incubators are going to be more expensive. And the reason why they're more expensive is because you're not only paying for the space, you're paying for the community that incubators are building around it. So incubators will have almost every day some kind of educational event where somebody will present or somebody you can come and talk to about questions. They'll have attorneys and CPAs and consultants and whoever, and software engineers and anybody you can think of. You can talk and brainstorm and get advice. They also have a ton of networking events, meet and greet and have beer after hours and get to know people that are in similar shoes. Because at the end of the day, it's all about learning from mistakes that other people have done. So it's so important to communicate and be part of this community and hear what other entrepreneurs are doing and learn from their mistakes and try to figure out how to not repeat. And finally, the nonprofit organizations. And here in the Triangle, we have a lot of different nonprofit organizations that are supporting entrepreneurs and small businesses. And again, membership and your involvement with them is all about networking and building your portfolio and establishing more contacts.